Welcome to the Offer Education meeting. We are really glad to have you here. My name is Lucinda Bateman, and I'm a physician who takes care of patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. I'm also the executive director and on the board of Offer, the organization for education and the organization for fatigue and fibromyalgia education and research. And I made that name up a long time ago. So we welcome you here, and we have some board members here and many wonderful people. We're really glad to invite you to our meeting tonight. Before we start, I wanted to make a couple of announcements. I want to tell you that there's a flyer up here if anyone's interested for a project, a research project being conducted by Dr. Fred Friedberg, who is the president of the International Association of Chronic Fatigue Syndrome. And he's doing a nationwide study. And if you're interested in finding out about becoming a patient or someone you know, you're welcome to come get a flyer afterwards. Also, wanted to tell you that Offer is planning a conference. You know, we do a conference every year or two, and this year our conference is going to be specifically an education conference for mental health providers. We're going to bring mental health providers together and talk to them about how to deal with chronic fatigue and chronic pain when they're counseling people about living with it, so they understand the physiologic side that goes with the mental health side. So you might want to be thinking about that, learn about it on the Offer website, and direct your mental health providers or anybody you know who you think would benefit from coming to the conference. It's going to be in September. So tonight, we have the topic of our education meeting is called CFS Miracles. And this is a panel discussion. We have eight nervous people sitting in front of you who I'm sure will be very humble about their accomplishments. But these are all people that I know very well because I have had the opportunity to interact with them as their physician, and they all have chronic fatigue syndrome. There are all kinds of miracles. Sometimes we think of huge miracles, but miracles are relative, right, to our situation. And what I wanted to do was bring each one of these in to talk about something about them that I think is a little miracle or a big one for them to accomplish given their illness and their illness limitations. So each one of them is going to share some of that insight with you. And the way we're going to do this is I'm going to do a brief introduction of each of their miracles, and then we're going to ask them some questions, and hopefully we'll address each question one by one on the panel, so you get a little bit of idea of what it's like for them to accomplish these miracles. So I'm not going to spend too much time, but our first panelist is Sherry, and she went on a vacation, a wonderful holiday vacation, when she thought she would never be able to do that again. So she's going to talk to you about that miracle in her life, and I'm sorry, but I wasn't able to get all the things I needed to make her slide, so we'll have to get it from her in person. Oh, I thought these out of order. So these are our panelists, and add Sherry onto that. Bethany, John, Jessica, Lauren, Sharon, Scott, and Darlene. And Bethany's going to talk to us about not only she likes to make jewelry, but she published a book. John is going to talk to us about discovering and developing an amazing new talent, and being able to get back and do some education around it. Jessica is going to talk to us about creating a family, starting from nothing to something very busy and demanding. Lauren's going to talk to us about how she accomplished the job that she's still working on, but completing her higher education and maybe a few other things. Sharon is going to talk to us about the challenge of arising from very dire circumstances, in specifically financial, but also she said it was okay to share this with you. She's really struggled with depression as a complication of her chronic fatigue syndrome. So she's going to talk to us about the miracle of her being here with us to talk to us about it after going through some of those very hard things. Scott, you may know Scott, created the Offer website and maintains it. And he also created a website for my office. So if you've ever visited either one of those places, you will know that that is the work of Scott. Darlene is going to be our representative, someone who's much, much healthier than when she was sick. So she's going to talk to us about how she accomplished that miracle. All right, so here are our questions for our panelists. And I'd like to start down on that end. If you just remind us of your name when you talk. Tell us, first of all, what your health was like. And this is just, you know, a couple of minutes about what your health was like, because we have all these questions to cover. Tell us what your health was like at its lowest point. Try talking then.
Hello? Okay, so health at the lowest point. That was a gradual process. The rock bottom definition changed over time. And I became ill in high school and kind of muddled through it. And I was one of those kids that figured out what I wanted to do really quickly, really early in life, and I was going to be a physical therapist and go to college and get married someday after college and have kids. So I had it all planned out. Well, after struggling and struggling for a few years of college, I was able to meet Jay, who's my sweetheart, and we got married, and I was working and not working, just kind of, you know, the roller coaster where you push yourself until you fall apart, push yourself until you fall apart. And the rock bottom point came when we had been married for a few months, and I was working a little job in a small town, driving their Meals on Wheels van, and I loved the job, and I loved being with the seniors, and I became so sick that I couldn't do that anymore either. And so it kind of became, what's the point? I can't work, can't go to school, can't, you know, everything I've tried to do just kind of crumbles like sandstone.
How many hours were you working doing that?
Oh, it was 2 days a week for 2 to 3 hours. So I wasn't able to sustain that level of work for very long.
My name's Bethany. On my worst days, the pain just reaches a point that it's all my brain can handle. It's really hard to concentrate on anything else. The weakness in my muscles is so bad that I shake when I exert myself, even just a very little bit. My concentration and memory retention is like non-existent, and my mind feels like it's floating around the ideas I'm trying to concentrate on, remember, or grasp. The only thing I can do on these days is recline on my bed and watch movies, Netflix or Hulu. Sometimes I can read or do Facebook games, but that's about it.
Tell them what your most the most activity you can do is physically right now. We're going to come back to that. I shouldn't jump ahead. Or say at your worst. Well, you kind of did.
I'm sorry?
Never mind. I'm jumping ahead. You did great. I'm jumping ahead in the questions. All right, let's keep going.
So, I'm Darlene, and I guess the worst I ever was, I kind of went in a period of one day from being very, very active, doing a lot of different things, to basically being bedridden. I just got the flu really bad, and I didn't ever get better. So I spent about 2 years pretty much flat on my back, and at first I was afraid I was going to die because it just felt like your whole life force had been sucked out of you, and I don't mean to sound melodramatic, but that's where I was, and so I kind of came to terms with that. Because, you know, I led a fun, good, long life, and I could come to terms with that, and it would be sad for my husband and children. But then I realized that I might have to live like this, and that was even harder, because it's you really don't have much of a life. So I could do self-care pretty much as long as I didn't have to do my own shopping or, you know, sometimes do some of those things. Every once in a while I could get out, but most of the time I was at home in bed, and that lasted for about 2 years at least. So that was my worst point.
At my worst point, I was not able to get out of bed, and if I did, it was sort of just barely getting anywhere, like maybe to the kitchen to grab a protein shake or something, and then right back to bed. Our TV was downstairs, and my bedroom was upstairs, and so I didn't go downstairs hardly ever. If I did, I would have to crawl back up. And the TV wasn't that much of a problem because I had so many, I was so sensitive to noise and the light and all that, that I couldn't watch TV very much anyway. So that's, and I had just lost all hope. That's where I was at my lowest point.
At my lowest point, I was in bed. I was raising 4 kids as a single mom. And, I raised my 4 teenagers from bed. I didn't think that I would ever get better. I thought that I would stay in bed the rest of my life. I could only get out of bed to go to the bathroom or to go to the doctor. And I had people come in and take care of me. That was my lowest point.
My illness, much like Darlene's, came on very suddenly. So one day I went to soccer practice, and the next day I was unable to bathe or dress myself or get out of bed, and just a really, really sudden flu-like onset when I was 12 years old. So that was about 10 years ago. So I was during the summer, and I was unable to make it to the first few weeks of school, but worked my way into going a couple hours at a time. So I was only able to be upright for maybe 1 to 2 hours at first, but obviously have improved a bit since then. So yeah, at my worst health, I probably gave up a lot of independence in terms of being an adolescent, which was difficult, but I also had the benefit of being an adolescent with my parents able to take care of me and give me piggyback rides up the stairs and stuff like that instead. So, yeah.
My name is Scott, and I also had the sudden onset after a bad case of the flu. And it was about 10 years ago. At my lowest point, I still have bad days, several a month, I guess, where I'm able to basically get up in the morning, fix myself something to eat. I check my email and check on the news, the stock markets and things. And my computer's about 3 feet from the foot of the bed, and the television is right next to that. So I recline in the bed from 11 o'clock until it's time to go to sleep at 9 o'clock or so at night. And I sleep until about 9 the next morning. So the that's what it's like. I guess it was worse for me.
Hi, my name's John. Mine started really when I was around 11-ish or 12-ish. It didn't, and it just kind of got worse over time. Missed a lot of school. Surprised a lot of people when I graduated from high school. Was able to work a little bit part-time for a few years, but never more than a few days a week, and only like maybe 6 hours or something like that at a time. Then I got pneumonia for about 6 months and couldn't do anything for 6 months. Still kind of feel like I'm playing catch up, getting back to where I was, you know, 8 years ago. Anyway, when I'm at my lowest, when things have been at their lowest, I can't any lights on. I can't talk to anyone. I can't hear anyone. Can't understand my own thoughts almost. I don't know how to really explain that. But it's just like everything is just out of reach, and all I can do is just lie down and sleep as much as my body will let me. And it's not the most refreshing sleep, but it's better than being awake and trying to deal with just the overload of sensory information or something. So that's, I spent many years in bed after the pneumonia. And it's just been the last few years that I've been able to do a little more.
So. Excellent, thank you. That may seem a little bit depressing to talk about people's lowest point, but it's a really important foundation for us to understand where the miracle comes from, right? And I'm sure any of you who live with this illness one way or another understand that this is a very common story, right? So although people are at different levels of function and symptoms now, they know exactly what that bottom place is. We're really, really sick. So the next thing I want to do, and we'll start on this end, but we're not going to make you start first every time, okay, Jessica? After this question, we'll start on the other end. Maybe we'll go back. So this time, I want them to tell you briefly about their current level of function, sort of just what you're able to do and not do now. But I really want you to introduce what your miracle is, what I asked you to come here to talk about, and tell us about it.
Well, I'll pick up where I left off on the last question at rock bottom, lowest point. And that really was at that kind of, we've been married for a year or a little more. And to be honest, that agonizing battle you go through, which is, what am I doing with my life? What is the point? It's a interesting illness. Because, you know, it's not a life-threatening illness, but it definitely threatens your life, and it threatens your will to live. So we're at this rock bottom, and what am I going to do? And we wanted to have a family, but that was the most terrifying thing I could think of. And I'm a really sensible, logical person, and having a child seemed like the absolutely most irresponsible, crazy, scary, painful, bad idea I could think of. And my husband was kind of okay either way, waiting or not, or he just felt like we can work it out. So I'd like to give credit to Dr. Bateman at this point, because she gave us this bit of advice that was helped us with that turning point, and in her office one day, and she said, you know what, you can't put your life on hold for this illness. You might get better, you might not. You might get worse, you might not. You never know what's down the road, and you need to figure out what it is that brings you purpose and joy, and figure out a way to do it. So I did that crazy, scary, bad idea, irresponsible thing, and we had our first little child. Benjamin is his name, and he really is our little chronic fatigue miracle. We named him Benjamin Golden because I'll start out, his dad is named Jonathan Golden, and because his mother looked at him when he was brand new and said, this little boy has a golden heart. And so I married a true man with a golden heart, and he is part of my chronic fatigue miracle as well, for sure. And so Benjamin, we looked at him and said, he's got a golden heart too. And I can tell you, after he's almost four, that little boy has a golden heart, and he is definitely my miracle. And he gave me the purpose to keep going. He gave me joy. He helped. Dr. Bateman describes a loss ratio with this illness, that there's an amount of loss that goes on, and anything you can do to minimize that loss is worthwhile and worth the sacrifice. And so I can definitely say it's true. So to sum it up, it took us 4 years, but we decided it might be a good idea to have another one because Ben was so wonderful. So maybe we get a great one next time. I hope so. And my current situation is this. I am a mom, but I'm not able to take care of him full time. And so we have a full-time babysitter. My husband will get him up in the morning, load him in the car, take him to our fantastic babysitter, and on a good day, I can go pick him up and bring him home maybe 3 p.m, 4 p.m is about when I can do it, and I can only do that maybe 1 to 2 days a week. Most of the time, he'll stay with the babysitter till Daddy gets off work. And sometimes I have dinner waiting, and sometimes I don't. Most of the time I don't. It's great, because they're picky eaters, and they'd rather have a peanut butter sandwich anyway.
My current situation is I'm unable to work at all. I am on Social Security. I am unable to go to college, and even getting a degree online presents some difficulty because I have such a hard time memorizing and studying and concentrating. And tests and quizzes are completely out of the question. So I'm unable to do those things. I currently have 7 diagnoses, though 3 of them are just general descriptions because they don't know what's going on. I have CFS, fibromyalgia, POTS, and a rare mystery condition that it presents itself as progressive muscle weakness. And that has continued to decline. It's slow going, thank goodness, but it is continuing, and we don't know where it will end. I have extremely low levels of 2 neurotransmitters in my body, and that's a test that is very rare. There's only one place that tests for it in the nation. They don't know exactly what it means. They know something's wrong, and they have proof that something is wrong, but they don't know what it means or why. I also have dysautonomia, which means that every automatic system in my body that's automatically regulated is having difficulties of some kind. That's actually a lot of systems if you think about it. Also, due to the muscle weakness, which is due to a mystery problem, I cannot walk at all or hold my own weight. My legs, if you stand me up, I will drop right in place. I am totally flexible. I can move. I'm not paralyzed. I can feel. I have extra sensitive nerves, but I just cannot walk. So my mom helps with my care, and my dad and my brother haul me around the house, piggyback sometimes, or just carry me in their arms. I'm very blessed to have a family that's willing to look after me and believes me in spite of everything. Let's see. So that is how things stand with me. My miracle, I credit it as having come from my Savior, Jesus Christ, because He's the one who gives me the will to go on. He's the one who gives me my self-worth. And I know that I'm forever loved and held in His arms. He helped me figure everything out. I thought I might be a musician originally. I wanted to go off to a college in South Carolina and become part of a music group there and play my violin and everything. But playing a violin is just too strenuous for me, and there's nothing I could do about it. So I kind of locked those dreams away in my heart, and I was telling God, well, if you don't want me to have that dream, then Lord, I need you to change my desires and my dreams to fit yours. And He did. Through a series of circumstances, I needed something to do, and I didn't really have much to do in bed, so I've always enjoyed writing, so I just decided to try writing. And I chose biblical fiction as the basis for my story. I chose the book of Esther from the Bible. And I really enjoyed doing the research for it. I mean, how much archaeology do you get to delve into? And they're making new discoveries every day that are about ancient Persia and the kings of old and everything. So I really enjoyed researching it. I enjoyed writing it. I love making characters. I love writing characters. So I really enjoyed it, and I titled my book Star of Babylon because the name Esther means star, and she was the queen of Babylon. So It is historically accurate fiction. I did a ton of research for it. I wanted my book to be as accurate as you could possibly make it, historically and biblically. Let's see. It took a period of 5 years to write my book. I started when I was 16 years old, and I'm now 21, and now it was published this spring, in April. So, it took a long time. It's not one of those things that you can do overnight. You have to work at it, and you have to be patient with yourself. Not get frustrated that you don't have more days that are better to write on, and all of that. So, if you would like to see my book, I have it here. I think it turned out really beautiful. I guess that's skipping ahead to the next question, so I won't do that. I think that's about it for that question. But it's funny how miracles take a lot of work, a long time. My miracle, I don't know if it's going to be up there, but sort of my functioning level right now is that I can fake normal. Really, I'm pretty good at it. So, the next picture, the camping after, well, we went backpacking, and to me that was a miracle. I love the outdoors. I did about any outdoors thing that you would want to be able to do, and obviously couldn't do any of that for a lot of years. So there's a picture of me in the blanket, and that is when I actually could go. But I was lucky. My husband is a gadget guy, and so he was always, you know, coming up with things so that I could go, and umbrellas and, you know, ways. And so that was good that I could, you know, be with the family and with the kids. And there's a picture of my three children. And if you look, the one sort of thing that's all covered up, he has my backpack. He's carrying on in front of him. But that was just the last little bit, and that was one of the contingency plans. We had strapping young men go with this. But you can go in the Uintas and hike a mile or two, and it's like you're in the wilderness. So we went on this camping, you know, backpacking, and it was just amazingly wonderful to me. And it's miserable up there, and there's mosquitoes, and there aren't toilets, and I just don't know how. I just enjoyed every last second of it. But I did, and we've actually been three times, and so that was fun. And my mode of operation now is I mosey, and I can mosey along. If I mosey, I can, you know, I used to be, I can't get around the block, but I could get around the block now. If I mosey, I could go around the block, and at this point, I could probably go around it twice. And that is really a miracle. We moseyed all the way up the mountain, and we moseyed all the way back, and it's actually kind of fun. You get to see all the things along the way. So that's my miracle, and I function quite normally as long as I keep a certain set of parameters in balance, and as long as I can sort of, you know, not get going too fast, then I do really very well. So that is a miracle.
My current limitations, I have orthostatic intolerance, and so that keeps me off my feet for most of the time. I don't tolerate being able to stand or walk for very long at all. I still have problems with cognitive issues. I'm still pretty sensitive to noise. I can't work, and I do about two activities, light activities a week. So it's a doctor's appointment and it's offered, and that's about all I do for that week.
Okay.
I'm really, really lucky to have a husband who has come around and is really supportive and does pretty much everything around the house. He does the laundry, he does the shopping, he does the vacuuming. So that's really great. My CFS miracle is that I had a family function that was really important that I really wanted to go to, and it was in California. And I didn't, my wildest dreams didn't think that I would be able to ever manage something like that. But it's a miracle because I was able to. So I'll tell you more about that on the next round around.
My current limitations are so so much improved over how they were. I'm able to live quite a normal life, and sometimes I forget how sick I was. Until recently, I held down a part-time job for 5 years, and I'm able to play with my grandchildren and take care of my mother and take care of myself. And it's just a drastic change and a big improvement. I'm on disability for depression, but I'm dealing with that and the chronic fatigue and the fibromyalgia. And I've been able to, that's my miracle, I've been able to survive financially and take care of all three of those.
If I could just add something, and Sharon gave me permission to do this, but when I met Sharon, she had 4 small children and was sick with chronic fatigue syndrome that no one had ever diagnosed, along with her depression, and she didn't have enough money to have a car. So if you can imagine trying to raise 4 children when you're sick and can't work and don't even have a vehicle to go where you want to go, and on top of that was very severe depression. So when I thought of this panel, I wanted to include Sharon because I think her life is a miracle. Her kids are off and grown, and she's living independently, and she's learned about both of those illnesses and has made a wonderful contribution to her family and to the places she's been able to go work part-time. So to me, she is a miracle and a very big inspiration to me, along with all of the others. May not be quite as tangible of a miracle, but it is to the two of us because we know the story.
I guess my miracle is a miracle in progress. Dr. Bateman asked me to come and talk about completing higher education goals, and I'm not quite there yet. I'm on the 5-year plan so far in getting my bachelor's degree. But I... Last semester, I had a full-time course load, which was 12 credits, so that was quite an accomplishment, which was the first time since elementary school that I've been to school for the full time. And I guess talk about more specifics in the next question.
I wanted to tell you more about the pictures, too. You want to mention the torch?
Sure. I don't, they all the questions kind of bleed together, so I don't know.
I know,
there's no where I talk about what I should save for when.
You tell about the torch, yeah. I'll tell about the other one.
Okay. Graduating from high school is at the right, which was a really big deal. I was able to do it with my class, which I worked very hard to be able to do. And then on the left, this New Year's, I did a, Alta does a New Year's torch ride. I was a skier and soccer player and very active before I got sick, and gave up skiing for the most part. Over the years, I've gone up and done one run on the Bunny Hill, and that has been great, but I can still go skiing, sort of. But so, yeah, this New Year's was amazing. I went with my dad, and you just go really, really slow down the mountain, holding a torch. So that was an amazing experience, and I felt very glad to be able to participate in it, even though it's just one run, and certainly not the skiing that I used to do, but it was really great.
And I put the other picture in because I took it. This is kind of part of the education theme.
I just thought that holding a torch was perfect for the miracle theme.
It's true.
Carrying the torch.
The torch and the fireworks, right, up there?
Right.
But the other picture is Lauren when she was 16, and I had her read at one of our events an editorial she sent into the paper about chronic fatigue syndrome, and they published her editorial when she was 16 to try to raise awareness about chronic fatigue syndrome.
Responded to some negative publicity about chronic fatigue syndrome in the paper since then. So, yeah. Trying, but I don't know how much of an impact that's made. So,
well, before I became ill, I was working about 60 hours a week in my profession. I was a stockbroker for about almost 20 years, and also serving in my church and remodeling our house. And from the moment I woke up in the morning until I went to bed at night, I had to be doing something, and was very busy. And when I became ill, all of a sudden all those things went away. I couldn't work anymore, and I had to give up carpentry and plumbing and electrical work, which wasn't a terrible thing to give up, but I also had to give up church service. I found that sitting in a meeting for an hour and 20 minutes was tough. Sitting in a meeting for 3 hours was impossible. So I had to find some other things to do, or I would have gone crazy. My kids already say I'm crazy, so that's no change for me. My wife is a professional genealogist, and she asked me to set up a website for her. And I didn't know anything about it. I had no idea what I needed to do. But I went to CompUSA, and I bought the most current software available at the time. It was called Front Page. It was by Microsoft. And basically, Microsoft just took a product they already had. It was Word. And they just changed it a little bit and tweaked it so that it would write in HTML code for the internet. And so I designed a web page for her, and we put it out there on the internet, and she got some business from it, and worked pretty well. In addition to that, I found some other things that I've had to do to keep me from going crazy. I also do some indexing, where every day I take a page like from the 1940 census and type the names that I see on the 1940 census into the computer, and that's going into a database that will be available for anyone that wants to see it. A friend of mine asked me if I wanted to go shooting one weekend. I told him about my illness, and he said, well, we'll just go for an hour. So we just went for an hour, and I've been around weapons all my life. But he decided to show me how to shoot a handgun. And so I found that was really enjoyable, just to go out and shoot a handgun. It seemed to work off some stress, too. Just try to hit the center of the bullseye. And so I've learned about that, purchased a couple of handguns, know a little bit about it now. I did try to go fly fishing. I thought that sounded like it would be a great thing to do. But by the time I got up to whereas I planned on fly fishing, I was too exhausted, and I turned around and went home. So that didn't work out too well. I have about 3 or 4 hours a day that I can really do things, and with the computer so close to my bed, if I have an idea, I can get up and go to the computer and work on something for a few minutes. I purchased some books, like Web Design for Dummies, And I found that I would read the page, and by the time I got to the bottom of the page, I'd forgotten what I had read at the top of the page. And I'd do that two or three times, and I decided I was just too dumb to read that book. So that didn't work out too well, but I did find an online source. It's lynda.com, L-Y-N-D-A, and they have live presentations on software. And I found that if I watched someone do something, then I could remember what it was. And now I'm working on the website. There are so many new devices out there with smartphones, tablets, and everything. I'm working on a new website that will work with those devices and work across all those different platforms.
This doesn't do justice to the website. Of course, this is my phone taking a picture of the website, which is why you can see the time and the AT&T, but I'm not as smart as Scott. I couldn't figure out how to put the website on PowerPoint. But it sounds pretty ingenious, didn't it?
So, by the way, I've actually done some of the indexing he was talking about. It can be like trying to read Sanskrit. It is awful. I applaud anyone who can manage to read that horrible chicken scratch. Anyway. So, as I mentioned before, I had pneumonia for 6 months, didn't do anything for 6 months because I couldn't. After several years of just telling myself, you know, I'll just wait until this passes, then I'll get going with my life. Finally, I became a patient of Dr. Bateman's after a severe stroke of luck. A gap in the waiting list, apparently. And thanks to her, it kind of dawned on me that this is not something I can just wait for it to pass, because there's no guarantee it will. So I decided to try to go back to school. I only did one class a semester, one at a time, much to my academic advisor's hatred, which I don't really care about. But anyway, so I decided to try to come up with something that I could do as my energy allowed, and on my own time. So I had always wanted to be like a character designer or an illustrator or something. So I enrolled at Utah Valley University in the illustration program, and after just 2 or 3 semesters, I was actually pretty sold on not being an illustrator. It's very demanding. There are a lot of very tight deadlines, and it's very perfectionistic, and a lot of people can do that, but it didn't work for me. So I moved from illustration. That's where the two at the bottom and the mantis up in the right are from my illustration class. My illustration teachers said my style was too cartoony and wouldn't work well in illustration. And that I didn't explain enough in my pictures. For the assignments for the class, we were given, the one up top was, too late he realized he should have ducked, or something like that. The damage had been done, or something like that. So I did a mantis with a plate. I don't know if you know, but mantises eat their husband's heads. So he's across the table, headless, and she's got mandibles on her plate, looking very satisfied. Anyway, he thought it was too morbid, and it wouldn't work well in illustration. So, you know. Yeah. Anyway, so I moved to animation, and I was told my style was too detailed for animation. So I'm too cartoony for illustration, and too detailed for animation. Okay. So my genius animation teacher, he was a good man, he said, well, you seem to really like to draw characters and clothes and accessories and things like that. He said, why don't you try like costume design? So that's what I did. I moved into the costume construction and design classes at UVU and just loved it. Just absolutely loved it. I got to think with patterns and colors and just whatever I wanted to do. Of course, then the problem came with I can design whatever I want, but then I have to actually make it. That's not so fun. Well, it's fun to make things, but it's a lot harder to make. Anyway, so yeah, the top three pictures, the white ones, are designs for a production of Androcles and the Lion, the children's version that I'm actually going to be doing all the character designs, the costume designs, for UVU this fall. You know, I still take one class a semester. I can get up and go to class most of the time. Sometimes it's a matter of pulling myself out of bed, getting myself to class, and then the moment she says that class is over, I bail. I go home and I sleep for 10 to 12 hours because that's just how my body adapts to things. I was last semester able to do costumes for, I didn't have to make them, it was just pulled from there, the warehouse of costumes. But I had to do several very long, long days. I would be at the school, not on my feet, not working the whole time, but I would be at the school for like 10 to 12 hours, several days a week, for a couple weeks in a row. I sat as much as mortally possible. I ate as often as I possibly could. And I would just vanish from time to time and just take a little nap or just find somewhere with no sound, no people, nothing. And then as soon as I could go home, I would go home and eat something and just crash. So that's kind of where I'm at now. I can do things, I can push some things, I can push myself hard for certain amounts of time, you know, do things for class and stuff like that. But, you know, there are a lot of things my teacher wanted me to do that I couldn't do. It was not an option. I'm quite stunned still that I managed to pull off what I did last semester and that I'm not just flat in bed this summer. I take every summer off without question because I need time to refuel or else I'll just go completely flat. Anyway, so.
Excellent, thank you. Okay, now I'm going to tell you that we've spent the first hour, but it was well worth it to listen to those individual stories. So I'm going to ask you to do something challenging, you people on the panel. We're going to go around one more time, and I want you to consolidate these questions and just say what you want. So how did you do it? You sort of explained, if you want to add anything more about how it was you did it and maybe incorporate in your discussion what it cost you, not just money, right, what it took to do it. You got to be really short and brief because there are eight of you, right? What were the costs? What were the benefits? I think you've also talked, you don't have to say anything you've already said, but if you want to add something, and then just a piece of advice. Are you? Are you okay? Just start back down there, Jessica. Give him a little rest.
Yeah.
All right. So, 2 minutes max. We'll start down at Jessica. So pass that mic back down. And you can take a look at those questions and decide how you want to summarize whatever you want to leave with people about what this cost, what you got out of it, and what it took, and what you devised to other people.
I'm really glad you said that, because I was going to do that anyway. Combine all the things into one, because that's how it was running. I was laughing when I was reading that, because reading about how I accomplished it and the costs, and they seem like same thing. For example, how we did it, well, we live with my parents, we have a full-time babysitter, and the costs are living with my parents, having a full-time babysitter. I was just kind of thinking, how could I describe some of the costs? And I thought of a few just little things, including growing a baby for 9 months is rather torturous. And I consider being pregnant full for a year, because you have to get ready beforehand and then you still feel totally messed up after for quite a long time. So a year is a lot. It's a lot of work to grow a baby. It's a lot of work to take care of a baby after. Some of the costs include cleaning up throw up in the middle of the night, even though you're so tired you can't see straight. Listening to a screaming baby even though your head hurts so bad. Anyway, they include crying more than your child does when they get their own shots. And holding down a little boy getting stitches, even though he can hardly, I felt like I was crying more than he was. Money is a very, very big cost for us. Not only am I not able to help make money to provide for a family, but it's costing money to pay for childcare and all the expenses with our little angels, and the physical pain. Another cost that I wanted to add is some hidden costs, some hidden sacrifices. For example, my husband, he probably would have pursued a more aggressive career path that would allow him to have a higher paying job, probably, which most jobs in that category involve long hours, traveling, a lot of demand that way, and we decided that we can't afford him to have crazy hours, and we can't afford him to be gone. So we kind of pay for it that way, by taking more of the steady, little bit less demanding job, but less money. So if you know of any jobs that you don't have to travel or work a lot, let me know. We pay a lot of money. And a cost but benefit is living with my parents, which is fabulous, but it also is a little bit difficult. No one plans on raising their kids in their parents' basement, but they're there for us in a financial manner and also in the support and backup that we need with our kids, especially now having two. We are really, really thankful for them. Now, I just wanted to talk about the benefits I've gained, because that's to me why we're here tonight, is to talk about not only just how hard it was and how, you know, what a miracle, but what a joy it's brought. And like I said, this little boy, I can't say what a joy it is to be a mother, even though it is so hard. There can be times where you just want to drop him off at the corner orphanage or something, and then the next minute he'll say something that'll make you laugh your head off. It's been great as a marriage. My husband and I have grown together. We've overcome a lot. We've we're two new people now than we were 6 years ago when we started this journey. And I get to see, I get to still be a mom. And that is what it all boils down to. Even though it's not the way I want it to be, even though it pains me to have somebody else raising him and taking care of him all day, at the end of the day, I'm still his mom. And he's still the one that comes home and is so excited to see me. And I'm glad that I have the opportunity to stay home and rest most of the day and kind of have take care of me time so that those few hours in the evening and on the weekends, I can really be there for him. And I might be able to take care of him a little bit longer, but I don't think I would be my best self. So I think that is a huge benefit to our miracle, and I'm glad we've made the sacrifices. There were times we both thought we were going to go out of our minds, and why in the world would anyone have more than one? Well, we'll find out what two is like pretty soon. And I'm just so thankful. And advice I would give would be to not give up. And I think everybody would probably say the same thing. But find whatever it is that fills up your little heart and do whatever you can to get it. Even if it's in little bits, even if it's a compromise. Kind of like I've had to compromise to be a mom. I had to give up a lot of the parts I was so excited about, you know, getting up and going in a jogging stroller with my baby. That doesn't happen. Or going to the zoo and things like that. I'm thankful to have a babysitter that will still take him on all those things, and he's not missing out. But I even though I am, I'm just so thankful, and that's my miracle. And thanks for having me over tonight.
Well, on my best days, I spend it out of bed as much as possible. I go downstairs, do crafts, puzzles, and such. And you already heard what my worst days are like, so I had to compromise, and when I write, it is on my in-between days. days where I don't really want to get out of bed, but I still have a clear mind to think and to create. Let's see. I try not to worry about how long things take. Instead of setting like deadlines and, you know, specific date I need to be done with such and such, instead of doing that, I try to set small daily goals. Just something that I can concentrate for that day. And it really doesn't matter how long it's going to take me, as long as I know I'm going to finish it in the end. And that's what happened with my book. It took 5 years, but I did it. And I didn't give up. I try to push myself enough, but like to stay within my limits. I've learned to read my body, to pay attention to when I'm starting to get tired. Maybe I'm starting to get a headache. It takes a bit of trial and error to figure out what your limit is. So if you don't always succeed on one day, then don't worry about it. You'll try again the next time you're able to. I shift around when I'm writing. I have my laptop, and I recline in bed, sit up. I have a bed that allows me to sit up, thankfully. So I sit up in bed, and I set my laptop on my computer, and I write. And So every now and then I will shift around, lean more this way or that way, take breaks, stretch my neck, you know, all those kinds of things. Sometimes I just do something different for 5 to 10 minutes. Then I go back to writing. So I don't feel overloaded. You just have to kind of listen to your body and figure out ways to do things. If you're determined enough, you can figure out a way to do something. It may not be the way you want it to be, but you'll do it. As far as recovery, it takes I just sort of have to roll with the punches, just relax and not worry about it. I make sure that all the time that I use is wasted. If I'm not wasting my time, if it's worth the payback, then I don't feel stressed because it was all worth what I did. And my publisher has been very accommodating. She understands my illness and actually suffered from fibromyalgia herself for quite a few years before she went into remission and hasn't had to deal with it since. But she understands where I'm coming from, and so she was real good about not giving me specific deadlines, maybe just a generalized deadline. And I thank God for that, because it would have never worked if she wasn't able to work with me on that. As far as payback, I have pain, I have migraines, I have muscle tension, which tends to lead to the migraines. I'm utterly exhausted, shaky, weak muscles, and very spacey up here. It's really hard for me to concentrate on anything anybody is saying. So, you know, those are all my paybacks. As far as sacrifices, I have to make choices. You know, if I'm going to do something later in the week, am I really going to want to write now? Because that may affect later in the week. Or if I'm going to write today, then I better not plan on the next 2 days being able to go downstairs and do beaded jewelry or puzzles or whatever it is. Balance is a major part of figuring out what I can do. I have to learn what to balance, what to do, and it does take trial and error, as I said. Take it one day at a time. Don't always look to the future. You know, it's good to have goals and to have generalized goals, but to say that I'm going to be done by this certain date, that's not realistic for us. But to set generalized goals and then to concentrate each day on doing your best to do for that day what is going to make up for it down the road, is going to make your ultimate dream come true. So one day at a time.
Bethany, I'm going to interrupt. We need so much more time to do this, but we don't have enough time to hear everything I asked them to say, actually. So they were prepared to answer a lot more. So I'm going to end with that really good advice about taking it a day at a time. The rest of the panel, I'm going to challenge you. What I'd like you to say is advice. Okay? Let's roll together what advice you would give to someone listening to this panel today. And let's hear from the rest of you.
Okay.
So I'm going to have you pass that on, unless you want to say one more thing.
Yeah, I did. And that is just to be positive, you know. We always see the negative in things. But if you think about it, you could find something good about your situation. So play the Pollyanna's glad game. You really can't find something. You know, somebody who's worse off than you are, a way that your situation could be worse. There are things to be thankful for about your situation. And so, you know, you need to stay positive.
And I wholly agree with that, but there was a point in my life where that was really hard to do, especially if you're struggling with depression or anything. Just maybe one quick story. I'll try to be really fast. Kind of at the lows, I was watching a program, and it was one of the Osmond people, and they're all perky anyway, you know. My idea is, anyway, I remember watching him and thinking, that's how I would like to be sick. You know, you can call people from your bed, and you can have, you know, the phone rings, and it doesn't just shock you because it's so noisy and horrible and awful. And anyway, so I was sitting there wishing that I had MS, and it was a nice, healthy disease that, you know, people could understand and say, oh, you poor dear, instead of, oh, so you're tired a lot? And, you know, I hated that. So I guess my price I finally had to pay was to completely sort of, he said at the end of the little thing, I have MS, but it doesn't have me. And I remember thinking, this owns me. I have whatever, CFS, whatever you want to call it, it is totally the boss of me. And I think I had to get to that point and realize that I can't fight it. You can't work harder than it. And that was hard for me. So I just had to realize that, and I guess this isn't my advice, you have to be so very, very, very vigilant that you don't cross your boundaries. And it took years and years and years of not spending more energy, and some years of spending more than I can and being knocked flat on my back again, to realize that you really have to live within the parameters that you have, no matter how tiny they are. And then another valuable thing was I had to give myself credit for the few things that I did do, even if they were little. I tried to read a book on cognitive behavioral therapy, but it's really hard. But I did get the idea you have to be nice to yourself in your head. So I decided I was going to give myself credit for brushing my teeth, because it's really hard. Your husband packs you up the stairs, and you don't have any energy to do anything, and the toothbrush, oh, minty, that's stimulation. You don't need stimulation, and then all the energy required, and then, you know, it kind of makes you gag. And the only thing that was worse was either lying there all night with icky teeth or waking up in the morning and thinking, oh no, I'm still melted and my teeth are fuzzy. So I decided that I would brush my teeth, and not only that, I would give myself credit for it. And when I woke up in the morning and I knew that I was going to have another spend another day in bed, at least my teeth felt good. And you give yourself a little bit of credit for even the little things you do, and just be vigilant at not overdoing. And week by week, ups and downs, then you can kind of get to the point where, as long as you, you know, leave yourself warnings or, you know, do what other coping techniques you have to do, that life can be good again.
I could speak for an hour on this, but I won't.
Some of the benefits that I gained from having a successful trip is I really learned the importance of planning. And so with this trip, I really did a lot of research, and I took out as many variables as I possibly could, so I knew what to expect. And so now I'm trying to implement that more in my day-to-day life, so that I get off the roller coaster and quit crashing and burning and then train over again. So planning and pacing is something I learned that was really important. I was very careful to pace and didn't do a lot. I really didn't do a lot on that vacation. I had to change my expectations, and that's another thing that I learned, and I go in and out of flux with that. But I had to come down to the point where I said, you know, if all I can do is sit in this hotel room, as long as I've got, it's where I want to be, which is a little hotel room, not a big over-air-conditioned one. That would have been miserable. And I just changed my expectations so that if that's all I could do was sit in that hotel or sit down on the sidewalk and watch people walk by, that was going to be enough for me. And once I got over that hurdle of expectations, then things were much better. So I'm trying to implement that, changing my expectations of myself and what I can do and what I can't do. And it requires constant evaluation on that because I tend to have pretty high expectations. And so to go from 100 miles an hour, as you all know, to zero is just, it's hard to make those mind changes that you need to make. The other thing I learned from this trip was having something to look forward to really helps me out a lot. And it doesn't have to be something big like a vacation. I mean, I don't know. I would like to do this again. I don't know if I'll ever have the chance to or not. But just having something to look forward to. So even if I don't have, you know, sometimes, as you all know, it's hard to nail down, oh, okay, well, we'll do lunch this day, this time, this restaurant, because, you know, it's a day-to-day, hour-to-hour kind of a thing. So, but I found that even if I have something, like if I call my daughter and say, so do you think one of these days we could go to lunch together at a quiet restaurant? And she says, sure. I said, okay, well, let's see if we can accomplish that by the end of June. It at least gives me something to look forward to, because when I don't have anything to look forward to, I find myself getting depressed and feeling hopeless and really discouraged. So my advice would be, listening to this panel is just so inspiring to me. I mean, never say never. You know, I listen to what each of them do, and I think, I could do that, I could do that, I could do that, I could do that. But change that mindset to never say never. Who knows, maybe I will. And pace, and then always try to have a goal, have something in your life that you're looking forward to.
I would just say ditto with what has been said, because I'm not a public speaker, but it can get better, and to take one day at a time, and have hope that it can get better. The thing that's encouraged me is my family and my grandchildren, that I can participate in their lives more. And that enriches my life.
All right. I think that much like life, people who don't have chronic illness, it's just a trial and error process, and that's what I've learned with any accomplishment that I've done in terms of how to pace myself and what I can do, what I'm willing to sacrifice to make that happen. But I think a good deal of my successes comes from just the luck of being surrounded by really wonderful, kind, smart, creative people who have guided me and produced accommodations without which I would not have been able to do as much college as I have to graduate from high school with. One of these people is, of course, Dr. Bateman. So I think that becoming an advocate, if you don't have one, is something that is invaluable for those with chronic illness. And with chronic fatigue syndrome especially, I guess it's hard to give this advice because I feel like it's more of a character trait than something that you can develop, but just patience and perseverance and being able to accept when you can't do something and to realize that you can't. And much like other people have said, just celebrating every little triumph, no matter how small it is or how large it is, as we've seen, it can be large. And it's all depending on the person and the illness. And with patience, I truly believe that things will get better for everybody. So even if it's a little triumph, one should celebrate that with all that you can muster. So
I have to agree with what has been said, and I think one of the hardest things that I had to learn was to be patient with myself. And it's easy, I think, sometimes to be patient with others, my kids or my wife or whomever, but I had to learn to be patient with myself. And I think, too, with this illness, you could just roll over and play dead. And but that's really not the answer. That's not living. And I found that I need to do things. I mow my own lawn still. I can only do part of it in a day, but I still do that so I don't just atrophy and die. And I think also doing things like the website also gives me intellectual stimulation. And I think that's really important, too.
I agree with what everyone has said. Patience and small goals. One thing which I guess kind of fits with all of that is it's easy to see. For example, I just turned 30 recently. I live with my mother. Can't work. I do one class a semester, and it's really easy to look at how this is how life is supposed to be. This is the mold that it's supposed to be followed. And I think one thing that's very important with chronic fatigue is to realize that the mold doesn't work for you. You have to find what works for you, as everyone has said. If you try to just do like many people will say, and just, you know, pull yourself up, force yourself to do whatever it takes to be normal, it's not going to work, and you're going to be miserable. That's not to say to give up. You have to find your pace and your timing, things like that. Never give up. I as many people, I'm sure, would love to just go, you know what? I'm just going to go do whatever I feel like doing. I'm going to go wherever I want. This is what I'm going to do with my time. And everything will be lovely. But Dr. Bateman has really helped me to understand this more. I still struggle with it. But just to realize that it doesn't work that way. You have to work with what you have and what you've been given. So I think gratitude for what you have, what you've been given, is also very important. So, for the people in your lives, too.
I wanted to add to that really quick, just that, I mean, to give it a more positive spin, I feel like you can still do those things, as long as you have,
as long as you're aware and willing to accept the payback, and you just need to be aware of what you're getting into, which is not always possible. But I just wanted to add that, because I mean, there are some things that if you really love that are worth paying for months or years for, I feel like. So with diminished help.
I wasn't trying to put it in a negative thing, like, you know, surrender, blah, 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 blah. Just learning to work within, you know, taking into account what the payback will be, what the penalty will be, and just learning what's worth it and what's in your best interests, and so on.
The example of that in you is, you know, you thought you could only manage that one class a week, and actually that was all you could manage until you kind of found your passion, and you found a way to maybe to take a chance and probably have a big payback during that week when he worked for 2 weeks really long hours. And sometimes when it's your passion, you find strength to do more than you think you can do, but you also might have a price to pay, and sometimes it's worth it. Maybe that's the way to look at it. Amazing. You can see why these people are my heroes. And these are very special people, but I want you to know, these are not the only 8 people I could have had come here tonight. There are many, many people who very quietly have their own miracles. And I just want to quote something from Mark Eaton. I don't know if you remember Mark Eaton. He's a very, very, very tall basketball player that used to play for the Jazz. And we had him come talk at one of our conferences many years ago about how to deal with chronic pain. I didn't know what he was going to say. I was a little nervous, actually, not knowing what he was going to say to the audience. And I remember when he told his whole story and went through everything he'd done to try to overcome chronic pain. And at the end, you want to know what he said was the solution? I'll never forget it. He said, find your bliss. And the solution to chronic pain was not the doctors, was not the alternative care, was not medications, was not MRIs. It was none of those things. When he finished his journey, he realized he had to do what made him happy. And he had to find what brought bliss and happiness in his life. And when he did that, his life and his battle with pain became entirely different. So remember what you've heard here, and hopefully you can take it a day at a time, and you can remember to view the glass half full as much as you can, and find your bliss. And thank you very much, and I appreciate you coming. All right, thank you very much, and we appreciate your time. It was worth the time. And it's going to be great.